I'll just start the public hearing for the Nason Farm subdivision on Nason Road. And we're going to get started, I think, tonight by letting Joe Stanley speak and at least give everybody who's here an idea of what's going on, if you don't know already. And then we'll open it up to questions or comments as we go from there. Okay, Joe?
All right, thank you. I'm Joe Stanley. I'm from Land Surveying. We have our office right here in Acton. I'm representing Charles A. Clinton Sons and Bill Plan, who are the owners of this property. Basically, what we're proposing to do is, the Plant family has purchased the entire lot that, you know, was recently logged pretty heavily. I'm sure people are familiar with where the trees were coming out. He purchased it from a logger that cut all those trees, and we're proposing in the very southwest corner of the property to do a small 10-lot cluster subdivision. I think it's about 650 feet of road. There would be 8 lots that actually access the new private drive, and then there would be 2 lots that access directly onto Nason Road. There would end up being about 10 acres of developed area and about 28 acres of open space that go along with the subdivision for the enjoyment of everybody who owns a lot in the subdivision. I mean, other than that, I think it's a pretty straightforward project. It's just a short straight road with a turnaround. And our client, Mr. Plan, has quite a bit of experience in construction and building roads. Beyond that, again, I think it's fairly straightforward. I'm happy to address any questions anyone in the audience may have about what our future plans are here or what our proposal is.
Well, we own the big white spot.
This side?
No, the white spot that's there, that's in the middle of the whole thing.
Says Animal Capo, but it's really...
Oh, okay, yep.
It's really owned by David Moreau now.
Yep, okay.
And I've been there since 2001. I was there when you were born. And I've talked to Billy, and, you know, I'm disabled, and he's disabled right now. And part of my disability is stress and anxiety. And I've already talked to Bill about the heavy equipment going by the house. And he said he would use the San Page Road. And he swore to me, and he said his word is good. So I'm taking him at that. And originally he had told me there were going to be 5 lots. So now there's 10. So I asked him when I talked to him on the phone, I said, well, why aren't you doing 2.5-acre lots, you know, like I have? And he said, well, the town thought I was going to disrupt too much of the forest. Well, if you've ever been back there and saw what the loggers did, he couldn't do anything worse than what they did.
Yep.
And they devastated that acreage. Because when I bought that house in 2001, Hannon said he was going to put in 5 houses. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, I'm just concerned about, you know, being inundated by heavy equipment driving by my house. Because I've been in peace and quiet since 2001.
Yep, with the exception of when that logging was going on, I'm sure.
Right outside my bedroom window.
I mean, I guess, you know, the whole point of the cluster provision in Acton's ordinance, and part of why we decided to go with this route, is it does shorten, you know, the length of the road and the impact on the land. You know, there is much more land here that, you know, he did have the right to develop, you know, if we did want to do bigger lots, but we would have created more roadway, there would have been more runoff, we would have needed to deal with things like that. So, you know, again, we thought the best use for everything was to tuck a smaller cluster subdivision here. And, you know, yeah, there will be some development alongside your house. I mean, a lot of the work has already been completed as far as rough grading in the road and things like that. And I'm sure Bill will certainly do everything he can to lower your stress level when it comes to finishing.
Yeah, he said if somebody else bought a lot, he has no control over that.
Right, but, yeah.
I understand that.
A lot of times, he sells to people that, you know, he may or may not have working relationships with. He seems to know everybody that I come across, so I'm sure he'll put in a good word at a minimum, you know. And on the plus side, there will at least be this, you know, 28-acre open space and then resource protection area, which abuts it, which, you know, quite frankly, makes it even a larger area that should be untouched out back there, so. I'm sure.
Yeah, those waters made a mess. That beautiful forest.
I agree completely, but it will, at the same time, the Mother Nature is pretty powerful. If it goes left untouched as an open space, I would think within, you know, a few more years, it's going to look pretty thick and pretty well grown again. That's our hope, anyway. Is there anything you would want to add to that, Will?
No, we finished a part of the road and became in off San Pedro to try not to bother you.
I appreciate that.
Is this going to be a town road?
No, it's proposed at this point to remain private, and the association with eight of the owners in the association would have, you know, responsibilities as far as upkeep of the road.
Are you aware of the problems with private road associations and how many of them have failed in recent years? They've got together for a while. It's very hard to get money from abutters to the road who will maintain that road. It's not an easy thing, and it's not a successful thing in most cases. It's the exception where it's a success. I think this is a real problem when you're servicing 10 families. And if they're small lots, obviously they're geared toward lower income people. They're not going to want to pay road association dues on top of their taxes and everything else.
But
I think
it'll
if
be
you're
well
going to do this,
to
it should be a town road.
It'll be well known to them when they're going to purchase. It'll be written right into their deed that
that's
the situation.
The road's going to be paved.
It's fine
so
when you first do it.
The road's going to be paved, so there's really the only maintenance
the
is going to be plowing.
And then they sell their
That's well, I assume it would be paved.
It is going to be paved,
but
yes.
But it doesn't really matter. I mean, paved and unpaved roads that are private roads have faced these problems, and it's a very big problem.
I agree. There are some that have gone south, but there are perfect instances, like, you know, even, you know, I spoke to the gentleman who runs up the road association there on 13th Street, which was a big... There was a lot that went on with that, and he's had quite a bit of success getting everybody. That's a very long road with a lot of different people, getting those people to pay, or he'll quickly files liens on the property and is able to get it all to work out. I mean, on the flip side of it, you know, the town doesn't want to take on maintenance expenses for this type of road if they don't have to and have all the taxpayers throughout the town.
If you bring it up to standards and put in an accessible turnaround, there's no reason why the town would not accept the road.
I would love to see the town take the road.
Well, if you bring it up to the proper standards, I believe they will.
It'll be paved and it's road specs when it's done.
Well, it has to be paved a certain grade, certain width. And a suitable turnaround.
Which I don't see that.
Which, I don't see that on your map.
What don't you see?
Turnaround.
It's called the hammerhead. It's at the end. You either have a cul-de-sac or a hammerhead with subdivision roads. This has a hammerhead.
I still foresee it being a major problem.
And why is it the lots, they're just a little bit bigger than a city lot? Is that correct? I mean, there's certainly not 2.5 acres, like...
No, that's cluster housing, smaller lots, yep.
So why you're saying that suggested you do it that way?
If I would have done a 9-lot or 10-lot subdivision with the 250 feet of road frontage that they asked for, it would have been a 1,500-foot road instead of a 600-foot road. So you're disturbing almost a third less, well, two-thirds less of an area.
But you have wells in all those, in that
yeah,
small
all your wells
area.
And septics have to be with a minimum of 100 feet apart, and they all are. More than that.
One of the first things that we had to do way back in this planning, sketch plan process, was show them a map where we could, the conventional lotting, utilizing a much longer road,
get that, get the same amount of lots in this particular area, which we could have done, but as Bill said, it would have impacted two-thirds more of the forest, you know, this way there is a 28-acre open space that will be left untouched.
Where is the
well? Well, it's pretty much already opened. I mean, I would rather see 2.5-acre lots.
Right.
With beautiful homes like mine.
Right.
Instead of, you know, some little prefab thing going in there.
These aren't gonna be little prefabs.
No?
These are gonna be all nice houses, and every house is gonna have a paved driveway.
Okay.
They're not gonna be little dumps, I can tell you that right now.
Are you building them all, or are you gonna sell the lots?
We're gonna work with contractors.
Okay.
Yep.
But the people can come in and put whatever they want there, correct?
No, I'm gonna be in control of every house that's built there, so no one's gonna build them. I'm not gonna have a nice...
So is there a standard for square feet, anything like that? I mean...
I'm not gonna let somebody come in there and put a modular home next to a nice home and ruin everybody's value. Then nobody's gonna wanna be in there. I'm gonna be in control of every lot, every house that gets built.
Aren't you actually dropping the values around that area anyway because it's cluster housing?
I totally disagree with that. Yeah, we're doing a 17-lot subdivision right now in Wells. Beautiful homes. Right now, say, smaller lots than these. It's actually a really nice neighborhood.
Because my house is the only one that this really affects.
Mm.
Because I'm a white block.
Well, you're right there.
Where are the wetland borders? Are they depicted on that?
Yes, I mean, they're probably tough to see from back there, but the wetlands were mapped by Kenny Gardner of JRK Soils over in Bloomington.
So how is that determined not to be wetland? Is it higher than the other land?
They check vegetation, and they also check soil samples looking for different types of material. Certain indicators that they see. So, you know, he actually, I was there when he did it, he went up, you know, he was going up and down in each direction until, you know, he'd start in the wet areas and go up the hill until he found indicators of dry soils and, you know, along with vegetation, those are the two things that they look at to determine this wetland line. And then the town has a 250-foot resource protection area around that wetland line. That's why we had to have it mapped, because the general mapping on the shoreland zoning map is, you know, sometimes more of an approximation than an exact thing. So we have to ground certify everything before we proceed with one of these subdivisions.
Yeah, so which way is the drainage going to go? I mean, am I going to end up with a pond in my backyard?
No, it's all designed out here at the end of, there's a culvert designed to catch the runoff from these lots, and it's all going to be, there's going to be a detention pond down behind the end of the road.
Okay.
How many square feet of each lot?
Around 30,000 to 35,000, give or take.
So that's,
you know, anywhere from two-thirds of an acre to an acre.
Almost three-quarters of an acre.
Yeah, on average, I would say.
Did you do test holes for the septic?
Yes, we ended up having to do two on each lot.
Two on each lot?
Yep.
Yeah. And what kind of soil is it?
There's various reports. It depends on which lot we're talking about. Overall, I guess I don't know off the top of my head. You know, they all passed as far as, you know, viable septic systems. And one of the things we submitted tonight was a letter from the soil scientist stating that. It may take me a minute to... Looks like there was a lot of scary soils.
Scary, yeah. Something looks to be. Is there any Colton soil around here? Toward the what?
Colton. Not
Colton.
He's got one. Lot 9, he's got. Or test pit 9, he's got a Colton soil.
Yeah. So it's changing quite a bit.
I mean, yeah, here and there. I guess, to be honest, I haven't sat down.
Do you think over the years, with the proximity of all those wells and leach fields in a scary soil or even in a Colton soil, you may get a concentration of effluent as well as possible pollution in the air because the lots are so small?
I mean, again, I don't think the impact, whether they're going to be smaller or a little bit larger on overall.
Oh, no, I see the economics of them. Like, you know, I'm building a road 500 feet or thousand feet, it's an economic thing. But I'm also looking at the town act and zoning where it's required to have 90,000 square feet for a house lot. Now, are you clustering these for economics with the intentions of, you know, giving more recreation area to someone, where somebody else could have to go and buy or use a 90,000 square feet? I mean, what is the reasoning behind it, other than the possible...
I mean, there's a little bit of both. I mean, quite honestly, I'm surprised. Most towns, if we go in with a conventional subdivision, everybody's there asking us to cluster it because it's less road, it's less impervious surface, there is going to be, you know, areas here that no one can touch, you know, two-thirds of the area shown on this map, no one can ever do anything with. So I'm sure there are some economics where it's nice for us to not have to build 1,500 feet of road. We can only build 600, but we, you know, it also, again, it leaves all of that open space for future enjoyment and
is that what's the topography? Does that slope off into the...
It's pretty flat.
It's fairly flat, and once you get to the back of this, it starts to slope down towards the wetland area. But the project area is more or less flat.
Well, I'm looking at the whole impact. I live on Sand Page Road. In fact, I go to the Boonies. When I go to Boonies, I go right by there. Mm-hmm. I watch the progress of the whole thing. Another thing that I think the planning board really, really ought to all drive down there and take into consideration whether Nason Road goes into Goose Pond Road, the angle in which it goes into and the increasing of traffic flow there, it's fairly dangerous. With more vehicles, whether there's, 10 lots, whether that's 10 cars or 20 cars or whatever, it's gonna increase. And I think that should be also looked into, the junction. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Oh yeah, I do. I mean, I've seen the state highway plan where they've had the opportunity to correct things there if they felt there was a problem, and this is what they came up with on the state highway plan. So I would have to look from here all the way up to Goose Pond, Route 109. They've made modifications over the years, including in this area. You know, there's state highway monuments that, and highway plans that includes this whole thing.
Isn't that a town road?
Right, but they've still stepped in a lot of these areas where there's bridges and everything, and a lot of these reconstruction areas, they've stepped in over the years and helped out. There is a state highway plan from West Shore Drive here all the way out to Route 109.
But do you see the impact of the increased traffic, whatever, you know?
Yeah, I mean, truthfully, I've never heard of an accident or anything that's
it's
happened.
It's yet to come.
So. I've heard people
come
down Mason Road, they don't see that stop sign, or they take off the stop sign and go right across to the...
They don't see
it. Oh yeah, right on the other end of Goose Pond Road, you can see people out in the Willy Wax there. I mean, quite often, I don't know what you would do besides put a stop ahead, you know.
Well, there's no speed limit sign on that road. You know, we're both handicapped.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm a little bit leery of all this traffic. Now, I would have much rather seen larger lots.
There would be the same exact amount of traffic if we did the larger lots.
Well, I would have rather seen a larger lot. You could put a nicer house.
Let me answer that for you. The planning board about 10, 12 years ago went to these conservation subdivisions to put all the people in the 10 acres and give all the habitat the 20 acres. Planning board went ahead and decided that these conservation subdivisions were the way they wanted to see it. And Eagles Trace, I don't know if you've ever been down through Eagles Trace. There's probably 15, 20 houses in there now, and they're all less than an acre, high-end homes down through there with, it must be 30, 40, 50 acres of conservation land out there, never to be built on again. If I had to have a subdivision next to me, I'd want it to be a conservation subdivision. If I had to live in a subdivision, I probably wouldn't want to live in a conservation. I mean, that's more of a city environment or something, but you're putting the people all into a small area, you're putting all the stormwater into a small area, and leaving that 20, in this case, 27 acres untouched for the habitat. So once we start looking at the bigger plans, we can try to connect these habitats together, so it's just not, if these people all had 5-acre homes, there'd be nothing left for the habitat.
Right, I understand that.
So in this mine here, we're putting everybody onto less than an acre, and then the habitat gets all the benefits from it.
Yeah.
And we're seeing less expansion, less stuff out there, and being able to leave a lot of it natural. So we forced them, the town forced them into this cluster subdivision or conservation subdivision.
Yeah. Billy said he wanted to make bigger lots.
Yeah.
But, you know, I'm just concerned that if they've got like 1-acre lots, they're not going to be able to put a nice, how big of a house can they put in there?
The ones all down the Eagles Trace is one of them. I believe the Oak Ridge down on the Shapley.
But those are smaller than the ones on Eagle Trace.
I think Eagles Trace is all around an acre.
That's less than an acre.
It's pretty close to an acre.
But it's less than an acre.
These building envelopes in a lot of instances are 70, 80 feet wide and 250 feet long. I mean, we could fit this whole town hall building on there. We could fit this whole complex on these lots if we wanted to. It's not going to be that crowded. I mean,
what's the average, do you expect each house value to be?
Around 200.
And that's without a garage.
Every house is going to have a garage. Every house is going to have a garage and a paved driveway. It's going to be a lot nicer of a development than you're thinking, I can tell you that right now. It's not going to hurt your value.
I trust you.
We're going to be building houses comparable to what you have.
Mm-hmm. I trust you.
We're shooting on the little bit lower
straight.
End.
You shoot me straight.
Yeah, I want people to want to live there.
Yeah.
I want people to be proud of where they live.
Right.
Nice yards, nice houses. When I leave a lot, it's going to be beautiful, every lot. So after a homeowner takes over, then they may not be happy with the way you take care of your yard.
I do the best I can with.
Right. But we're not going to bring anybody's value down. I can assure you of that.
Well, I have a country lawn. It always gets mowed.
Yeah.
You know, it always looks nice. You know, I take good care of the house.
You know? But I just want to put you guys at ease. You guys are trying to make it sound like these are going to be like trailers we're putting in here. They're going to be nice little homes. They're not going to be huge, high-end homes. I don't want to use the word affordable. They're not going to be $150,000 houses.
And then the two lots on the Nason Road, how are you going to approach that? Is that one driveway in, or is that two driveways?
There's, you know, you can kind of see, if you're driving by lot 10, if you've been out there at all, they've kind of got the driveway roughed in.
That's one driveway for two lots?
No, there's a single driveway for lot 10, and then over here on the floor.
Oh, there's a lot on that side, then?
For lot 1, there's a driveway.
So there's two different driveways? How are you getting onto the one on the new road?
I'm not sure I follow. There's the new road here for the 8 lots, and then this lot and this lot have their own driveway.
So you're going to have 3 entrances, new entrances.
Correct. Okay. We've taken site distances at all of those, and you know we meet the town standard for safety on all 3 of those entrances.
So how wide is that lot on Nason Road, the single one in the cluster there?
This one?
Yeah.
It's 267 feet of road frontage there.
And the other one?
250 feet.
Now that's a bigger lot on the right, is that correct?
No, this one over here is actually slightly wider.
Well, where?
The other right. Oh, sorry.
You're right.
Well, yeah, this one's a little bit smaller than this one is.
Smaller?
As far as the road frontage.
Okay, I'm just looking at the graphics. Okay.
There's different colors up there. If you look close, there's a right-of-way, the lot on the right. Single lot that you see, there's a right-of-way alongside that in these people's home that will be available for people to get into the back area.
They're going to drive or walk?
No, just walk.
I'd like to see the planning board address the juncture of Nason Road Spruce Pond. I mean, it wouldn't be much to amend that, square it off, bring it to a 90-degree angle, because it is, you must know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
Are you coming on the corner?
It's a tight turn.
It's not a tight, it's a blind spot. And I think it should be addressed, and I think it would be worthwhile, and I'm trying to tell you what to do to drive down there. Now the leaves are down, it's a lot easier to see, and just go around that corner. Go around about 30 miles an hour and find the stop sign. Because we live on Sam Page and everything's just been repaved. And now we are the new road in town. And we have everything, you know. And they come up Nason Road, because that's been paved, they jump the stop sign there and they come around and they pick up speed and they come around a blind corner and they're going quite a clip. So that, we're not saying people shouldn't speed or whatever, it's just everything's changing. The country is no longer, you drive, you listen down the road and that's your neighbor coming home for work because you know the car. So. But I think that should be addressed. There wouldn't be much to do. I mean, these people have the experience and the equipment to do it, and it would be beneficial for the town, it would be beneficial for anyone coming down that road.
Billy. My question is, he was just talking about a walking right of way. Would that be on the other side of the stone wall?
No, it's on the other side of the stone wall.
No, it's in the strip of woods that's still right there.
So you're going to cut those trees down?
Not cutting any trees down.
No. All right, so technically, the part of grass that I've been mowing for all these years, people are going to be walking down it.
I don't know. It's actually a wooded area. That 15, what is it, 15 feet?
12 and a half feet.
And I don't anticipate anybody even using it to go. I can't imagine someone walking down that subdivision road, going down Nason Road, and then turning it to walk up that right of way. Everyone's going to walk in their backyards to go out back, if they want to go out back at all. Mm-hmm. One of the things we had to put in.
What's the profile of your road there? They said, was it inch and a half gravel or inch and a half thick gravel?
You had a minimum of 18 inches of type D gravel. Then I believe 3 inches of type A, which is crushed gravel. We're going to put a couple inches of pavement on top of that.
What do you can get down there now?
Overkill everywhere. There's probably an average of 2 feet. Some places it's 3 and 4 feet of type D gravel.
Type D gravel, which is what?
6 inch minus, 4 inch minus.
I look fairly sandy to me.
It's gravel, good road gravel is sandy, granular for drainage.
I was looking. So you're gonna go with what, a 3 inch minus on top of that and then an inch and a half?
The next step now is crushed gravel.
Yeah.
On top of that and then pavement.
So what, how thick is crushed gravel? 3 inch?
Yep.
And you compact it. You're gonna compact it.
Absolutely, yes, okay. Yep. Anyone's welcome to drive in there. I mean, you can drive in there and turn around and drive back out. Anybody wants to drive in and look at it and see what's going on there anytime. Help yourself.
And so, Billy, what I'm getting at is on the side of the stone wall near my house, there's going to be a right-of-way where people can walk through?
Yes, there is a right-of-way.
There's going to be a 12.5-foot strip of the open space, which anybody in the neighborhood would be allowed to walk up through.
If they wanted to walk through it.
Right. It's not a public right of way.
Well, they have to walk all the way around and walk through there to get to Nason Road. And you're not cutting any of those trees, so.
In order to prevent people from encroaching on our property, we're going to have to put up a fence.
I think that's the last thing you're going to have to worry about is people.
Yeah, because it's not, they're going all the way around. They're not going to walk down through, you know. And if they can walk through there, good luck to them. There's more trees down in that path.
There's a 30-foot drainage easement straight at the end of the road, and if I had to guess, I would say if anyone's gonna wants to walk out back, they're gonna either walk there or they're gonna walk to the back of their lot and then out. I would think.
Shorter it that way.
Is that draining the road as well as all the lots and that one?
Excuse me.
Is draining the whole road? Is that what you're draining? Well, you had a.
The drainage easement, yeah, the drainage easement is to get the ditch, the water from the road to the retention pond.
So now, is the pond existing now? Or are you gonna,
no. Yeah. No, that's the next step.
So what do you? How do you dig that? Do you dig that down 12, 15 feet?
No, I believe it's going to be 6 feet probably, Joe, something like that.
I'd have to look at the plan.
We don't even think, the ditches are so flat, we don't even think that thing's gonna see water, except for a heavy downpour situation.
Well, it seems fairly level, but then does it drop off in the back?
It's still fairly flat, it drops off a little bit in the back.
So, I mean, you're gonna dig down 6 feet, you're gonna fill it with round rock?
Not gonna fill it with anything.
Yeah, it's designed at 6 feet.
It's gonna look like it's just gonna be a look at any retention pond at a school or anything, or just they're grassed in areas to take stormwater. It's something that will probably never, it'll be seeded and mulched at its completion, but it'll probably never be mowed or maintained unless somebody wants to do it. It's gonna be out in the woods, out in no man's land.
But so you don't anticipate much, that's fairly level all the way down.
Right, the road's fairly flat, we don't even think, except for an extreme downpour, which we get a couple every summer. Mm-hmm. We're not expecting really much of a flow of water down on the ditch, period.
So the rest of the property will be conservation and will not be developed?
Can't touch it, no. Yeah. What you see with that, would I give up 37 acres, I think, right there?
Well, the whole thing is 37 acres. This is just under 28, the open space we'd be leaving untouched.
So who owns the rest of that property? The homeowners or you?
Oh, that goes with the associate. That goes with the homeowners.
Okay.
That whole chunk of land goes with the project.
And they'll pay taxes on that.
Better them than me, right?
Any other questions, comments?
Yeah, okay, what you just said, what's the logistics of getting the homeowners to pay taxes on that? Is each lot assessed a partial value for the open land?
I honestly couldn't tell you how the town's going to handle that. That's a tax assessor.
Each lot would pay 10% of the balance out there. Because there's 10 lots.
Because there's 10 lots.
Okay. Now, where it's going to be conservation easement, the value probably is not going to be that high.
Right. It's going to be, excess land.
Excess land is all it is.
Right.
Yeah, so it won't be that dramatic.
Yeah.
So it'll be less tax than that's being paid right now?
No, it's going to be a substantial more because you've got 10 lots out there versus one.
Yeah.
And I'm sure it's in tree growth or whatever. So they'll have that penalty.
Will the homeowners association be able to add more house lots?
No. If the planning board approves this concept of the cluster housing, that's it. There could be no further development on that.
No group house, no tennis courts, no swimming pools.
Walking paths is about all they'd be allowed to do, as I understand it.
Okay, the other thing you said about drainage from the road, it's pretty flat. And you is there going to be like a depression? Like, normally you see like sort of a gully to the side of the road for drainage.
This road has that. The road is pitched in one direction, so all the water goes to one side,
okay,
to the ditch, and then to the retention pond.
Okay.
Yeah, because the road is literally flat. It pitches down just a little bit off the tar, but then it's for over 500 feet, it's just flat.
And what's the width of the road going to be?
It's 26 feet overall, but 20 feet of it will be pavement with 3 foot shoulders on each side.
That's a wide road.
Just the minimum standard.
It's going to be a nice road.
Yeah.
You're going to be able to pass two cars at once.
Well, yeah. You can't do it with 10 feet. You need some help.
It's too bad it couldn't be a town-maintained road. I mean, my electric bill still says Mason Road's a private road on my bill. Mm-hmm. And that was the first house there.
It's actually always been a town road.
Yeah.
Well, when I first moved there, they didn't want to plow it.
No.
They said it's a private road. I said, well, there's a house there now.
It was a town road.
And they only plowed it to the end of my property line.
It was a town road that the town voted to not maintain.
Yeah, because they said, we didn't plow that road in a gazillion years. I said, well, there wasn't a house on it. I said, I'm disabled, you don't plow the road.
Yep.
And they plowed it to the end of my property line, that was it.
Yep. Drain plow, it's nobody used it.
So there's not gonna be like an, like a marked walking path. It's just gonna be a right of way, if somebody does wanna walk through there.
We're not touching it.
So the property that's been cut over, that's just going to grow back whatever?
Yep.
All right.
The association would have the ability to maintain.
Made a bigger mess out of that than Billy ever could've.
Pardon?
They would have the ability to do timber harvesting out there. That's a permitted use out there, but that probably isn't gonna happen for 30 years.
Yep.
20 to 30, till there's a growth back there.
Hope you do it by then.
And even then, the majority of the association would have to agree to it.
It's right now, they actually left a lot of nice hardwood. There's a lot of nice hardwood trees.
Well, it's kind of, who is that, Wadsworth?
Excuse me?
Wadsworth, did that, Wadsworth?
Day logging.
Oh, Day's did it?
Yeah, day logging. They bought the land at auction, then they logged it, then they sold it.
Oh, that's what happened, yeah. I thought Wadsworth was in there, the one here is signing.
Any other questions or comments? Okay, thank you all for coming, sharing your interest and questions and comments.
I think Bill will do a good job.
I think as far as the meeting is concerned here, I think what we should do is get started and let's take care of the minutes of the last meeting before we get go any further.
Yeah, so you're driving there in time.
Yeah, absolutely. We're still working. We'll stop the rock here. Oh, yeah, that's going on.
Yeah.
I want everybody to wrap the light in to be happy with it.
Just be careful if it's muddy.
No, thank you. I was down there. I saw, that was going down.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you.
I've got beautiful aerial photos if you want to come and take a look too, if they have any questions. You know how to get a hold of me.
Oh, yeah. Well, now I know you are.
Thank you. Oh, Diana. Yes. Nice.
I was hoping you were going to call it plant road.
Plantation land, I think.
Plantation land? That's cute. With an E on it?
No.
Plant.
There you go.
They've done a good job in the last year.
They're all nice. I want people to want to do that.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, I want to do that in my house.
Right. Yeah, no, you want to build a ship, you're not going to be designing a house, you're going to be a nice house here. So, yeah.
Nice homes, you know, family home.
That's what I'm looking for.
No family, there's plenty of land, kids can play with that there.
I'd like to see the audio, it's nice for that.
The young family move there.
The audio from what?
They'll watch at your house or something.
It's usually. I used to take notes from it.
All right, that's one shot, I can't get them butts.
Or at least confirm them. No, but I can see the little bubbles going off there.
I try to keep my eyes from rolling so bad.
Body language, 80% of the language.
Yeah, my body language.
Determination.
Joe, do you have a copy of that detention plan cross section?
Yes.
Oh, we got the one.
brought two extras of the full size, just in case you ask that question.
In there, I just didn't want to get it all back.
Thank you, sir.
What do you think you don't have?
I was the only thing, well, that was one of the things on the list that I kept on. And so, yeah, we had just stepped out for a minute. So, yeah, we submitted the phosphorus reports that go along with that now, that the engineer prepared. It's page 4 or 5 that shows that we're under the allowances with this particular design. We've submitted the letter from Ken Gardner that was required, saying there were suitable soils test pit locations on each lot. And then we did submit that water quality report directly across the street for the new well that just went in. It was slightly higher in iron than everything else looked good.
I'm sorry, for that other well down the road?
Right, straight across the street.
Did you get some mark on it?
Yes. You were saying instead of a crown on the road, it's going to be
tipped one way, yep.
Yeah, we're seeing a lot of that now.
Which way is it tipped?
It's like, you can see it.
Towards the houses?
Yeah, if you...
Towards the new houses?
If you step back, you can almost see it on this detail. This is like a typical cross-section. It's leaning a little bit this way.
Okay.
And then it's going to come in and be stitched a little bit this way too, and then there's a culvert that goes under the end of the road and dumps everything into this.
Okay.
Well,
they're
getting there is like a little frog pond right there.
We had a wetland mat here. You can kind of see the edge of it, and that's something that was the biggest thing we had to take into consideration. All these
projects. Sometimes I'm doing that. Can you give
it to you? So this road should block it.
Thank you. Is there a second?
A little less mosquitoes.
Some pumps in there.
Questions, comments? All in favor? I guess it's just three of us that are going to vote to freeze it. Kevin wasn't here last week, so. Okay. All right, so on the agenda for the evening, first thing is this Mason Farm subdivision. And since hearing information from the public, any comments, questions from anyone? Throw it out to the crowd.
How much of a problem is Mason? Is the Goose Rocks Road down to Mason?
Goose Pond Road on the Mason.
Yeah, that's what the problem is. Because if you're coming down Goose Pond Road and you want to turn around, you need someone's coming out of Mason. There is a problem there.
There used to be a Y in the road there, looking at all the old maps and aerial photos. I mean, they have done some changes to try to make that at least a stop, you know, suitable for a stop sign. And, you know, I'm not sure the solution even is a planning board matter as much as the road commissioner if they want to deal with somebody. But I would assume they would have to take land from the person on the inside of the curb to situate that.
Yeah, I mean, it's not exactly something that you guys can fix.
Right, I don't know.
Like,
it's not like you're a Walmart. Then you put in those stuff.
But that rumble at one point had that other road. The other road right across from where the road is?
Yeah, there used to be a straight, you used to be able to go straight through there.
Is that like a private road right there, or is that
part of the road? There's a sign that says it's a private road. You know anything about that, Kenny?
What was that?
That
little one behind the mobile home there?
Yeah.
I'm not sure.
Who owns it? Because that was a sign up saying you can't, you know, private property keep
up. I think they just put it up.
To keep people up. But that was
another option if people wanted more.
Yeah. To come out square.
Because that's what I'm saying. Square right there.
That is directly my life.
I think probably the repaving of Mason Road is going to create more traffic than this has, but both of them at the same time is gonna generate more, obviously.
I'm parked over there, so it's gonna be much longer.
Okay, thanks a lot.
All right, any other, I'm sorry about that, this is the last part of that conversation.
We voted you as chairman while you were on.
I guess a couple of other comments that I had, you know, the thing that caught me that maybe we can deal with is how difficult of a thing do you think it would be to get a sign on to Mason, you know, speed limit sign?
I know the road commissioners are looking at all the roads in town for a speed survey with DOT and stuff like that. I'm assuming they're probably not gonna look at Mason Road because it was so low volume and low traffic, but again, where it's been repaved, it's now the shortcut.
You make the turn, it's downhill.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
It's quick to be in the 40s.
Yeah. So, I mean, the town could address that, speed signs. And that would give the sheriff something to work with. But I'm sure if it's not a posted sign, then it's 35, or there was some rule I remember for you, drive his edge.
It's 35.
35.
Not etched in stone.
No.
When I'm doing site distances, I have to assume 45 on the roads that aren't posted, so. You know, yeah, maybe some sort of sign or a stop ahead sign if they'd be willing to install one on that side. I don't know how many people read them, but
I don't think the problem's going to be the subdivision people. They're going to live there, they're going to know it. The problem is the people riding around at night drinking beer.
I agree.
Yeah, because when the subdivision people come out, they're not going to accelerate that fast by the time they get to Goose Pond.
Now, did I misunderstand the comment that the gentleman had back there, though, that is his concern going from Goose Pond onto Nason, or was his concern coming down Nason around the curve to the stop sign and then...
I think it was the angle that Nason hits Goose Pond.
Mm-hmm.
If you're going left, it's an easy turn. If you're going right, it's a hard turn.
Mm-hmm. But it almost seems like, why would you be making a right if you're coming down... Well, I suppose the people in the subdivision would be.
Yeah, that's right. What I was thinking. It's like, I would never go that way, except someone might be coming off Goose Pond Road.
It is a hard turn, that's for sure.
And there's a there's a chance there for crossing. You've got someone coming in and someone going out, and the blind turn, you can't see.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, like they were saying, there's people already overrun it. Is that what I've heard?
I don't know. Again, I see them down at the other end of Goose Pond Road. They overrun it like every
month.
Route
11.
Route 11. Right.
Yes. Route 11. That's a wide road too.
I haven't noticed it here. This, you know, obviously it's on my travel to and from work every day. I live on Goose Pond and work right up here on Route 109. I've never seen any indication of somebody going off there. I don't think you have a tendency to even go as fast on Mason Road. I mean, sure, I'm sure some people know, but it seems like everybody going down Moose Pond Road is going about 50. Sign sneaks up on them. I've often said, you know, if I put one of my little trail cameras down at the far end of the road, it would be hilarious to see how many different people have to fish themselves out of that little grassy swamp there. Yeah. But as far as it affects this, I mean, like he said, I mean, any new traffic generated here, I don't think they're going to gain any speed heading into that intersection. It's just a matter of them pulling out. You know, and if they are trying to head to Route 109 and they decide they don't like what they see at that intersection, it takes another 30 seconds to go right and then left to go up around and avoid it altogether. So, I don't know, I don't foresee a big change in impact in that area for this project, but I could be biased too.
Do we, as a planning board, have any control over roads?
Yeah, you could look at off-site improvements to see if that needed an island or a switch. As long as it's within the town's right of way, it would be something to do. Or you could have the conditional left turns at the end of Plantation Lane.
Oh, that would be a tough one.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Sure.
Right,
because
you
can
see left and right.
Left
and right. Especially in the
window
where you have to go up that hill.
Yeah, it's going to be tough to get up to Mason Road up into San Page. It's a steep hill.
Do you want room to
sent them out in the boxes, I haven't got any contact back from anybody.
Can we give them a note that it's a concern?
Yeah, they could put it on.
I think he's the summer, Dave's the winter, so we threw plans in their boxes, and I'm just following through with them, I've got it as a note here.
They don't have the areas anymore?
Summer and winter switch around sometimes, because of the mile of roads.
Oh.
There's more in the winter, and they have to offset some summer stuff.
So you think this one is gonna be controlled by Dave or Scott?
I think Scott did the paving out there.
On the same page he did.
Yeah.
I don't know about Mason, I don't know that. All right, any other comments? All right, are we ready to go forward?
Yeah, I just wanna clarify, just so that we're clear, the road itself, this private road does meet town standards.
And there'll be an engineered letter with a stamp at the end of it.
So if at some point this, they wanted to turn it over to be a town road, could they do that?
They would petition the town meeting, which some of the people said to do. But a lot of times towns are afraid to take one, because next year there'd be four more, and five more, and six more. There was a road committee around to look at some of these private roads years ago to just see what types of standards they met. And my biggest thing looking at them, to take them over before you take them over, is there a hill on the road? Is there a place to turn around? This is a flat road, it's simple, it's easy, it's paved, it has a turnaround at the end, this is a simple one.
I'd love to see the town take it over, to make it more desirable for people to want to be there and not have that road association. But
yeah,
the town's
going to... I was kind of talking about, you know, a couple of weeks ago, and I didn't get the sense that you guys were, you know, for...
I'd like to, but towns, all the experience I have with dealing with roads in the towns, no town wants a road.
They're dumping the roads.
They don't want anything to do with it, because it's just more money, more of an expense for them, so that they push private roads.
So what I'm hearing is that people are having trouble, but when it's a subdivision, I would imagine it's easy.
Yeah, the homeowner's agreement's in the deed before they buy it. They're well aware of it, and once it's established with the president and the treasurer and this and that, as soon as somebody's not paying, they put a lien on it. I would imagine.
That's exactly how it works.
Yeah.
Exactly.
So you're buying in knowing it's there versus... when a lot of the private roads or the town roads went private, or the town was taking care of them and they were private and the town stopped doing it, then you had to start an association on a road that you already lived on that was being plowed by the town and now it's not. That's a much bigger deal.
They had to get easements, and there'd be someone in the middle of the road that wouldn't...
Everybody had to...
That was a tough period.
Yeah.
I remember that.
And the best thing that could happen here is somebody that lives on this road has a pickup truck with a plow and wants to make the little bit of extra money and will plow the road for the association rather than them getting an outside contractor to do it. Mm-hmm. But plowing the road is, in my opinion, I think it's their only real big issue. Other than that, what's there to do on a little road like that?
You may be repaving it in 15 years or something.
Yeah.
And I can see them regenerating from a timber harvest out there in 15 to 20 years, about the same time that road needs work. So with that conservation area, that could generate the money to maintain their road.
I mean, they maintain that they can spend the money on, you know, sealing the cracks too. You know, so there's money that can be spent, depending on how, you know, how the association that's formed wants to go, kind of a deal. So...
taking the silt out of the detention pond, maintaining that, the guy mowing, whatever. There could be some small fees.
Yeah. Yeah. But it's still not going to end up being a significant amount of money, you know, for the family. Okay, where do we go? We ready to set this up? Do you have questions, Ken, that you want to propose?
The two notes you might be looking for off to the left. It would not fit in that note column to the right.
Yeah, we struggled with that.
17 and 18.
Yeah, but notes continue to go around.
I need an arrow.
I
need a magnifying glass.
Oh, well, I did bring two or three full-size copies.
I got the big one if I want it.
There's one right here, too.
Try to be economical with the paper in the ink.
Save a tree. Are you gonna prohibit commercial development at all, or home occupations, anything like that? That would be in the homeowners agreement.
I don't, I never even thought of it, to be honest with you. I can't imagine, what do you mean, as far as somebody wants to do something in their garage, or?
The first line.
Childcare.
Oh, all right.
Item number one in these documents as they're written right now, say lots shall be used single-family residential purposes only. Take that as you will, or what that allows for home occupations and things. But it does go on to say, commercial, industrial, professional enterprises are prohibited, except that home offices are allowed. If it's located in the dwelling and it's not advertised in the neighborhood. That's what we have in here right now to cover that.
Is there any, well, I just thought of the home care thing, but is that going to be prohibited? Because again, it's an opportunity for someone in the organization, in the...
Yeah, I hate to prohibit it, to be
right.
honest with you.
Right, no, I would too.
Yeah.
So...
Somebody wants to have a daycare, I mean, I don't...
I mean, it says home offices are allowed as long as everything is within the dwelling on the lot, it's not advertised in the neighborhood, and it doesn't, basically doesn't generate enough client base to need a parking lot.
Is that for the whole thing, or 1 through 9? 2 through 9? Or all the lots?
This was going to apply to all 10 lots.
Yes.
I'd like to not to apply to 10.
That's where I was going.
Yeah.
For questioning.
I don't want it to apply. I don't want 10 tied into the subdivision, period. Really, it's the only reason it's tied into the subdivision is that it's a lot on its own that I couldn't split without going through subdivision.
Mm-hmm. Well, and they should get access to the back.
Mm-hmm. Oh, they got it when we put that right away.
They have it, so.
Yeah, 10 actually is a lot on its own, really.
Well, yeah, I mean, it's...
Like, I know James is interested, and I don't want to tie his hands.
It's 3 times bigger than any of the other subdivision lots.
Well, how does it work with a single residential lot and home? I mean, what needs to be said to make some home occupations...
Depends on the zone, the use, and the type of occupancy they're looking for.
Yeah, that's more of your call, isn't it, Kenny, as far as what people can do? When they're
depends
what the zoning, what the zoning is,
and what it says on these notes here too is the zoning would be one thing, but if it's prohibited from your documentation, which it sounded like under that,
yeah.
You know, so you may want to pencil in excluding lot 9 or 10.
Yeah, excluding lot 10 for sure.
Next.
And make it clear that certain home occupations might be allowed
if they want it. Some of the subdivisions may not want it.
Oh, you mean if the association wants it?
Correct. And I mean, they could come back, or I guess, no, we wouldn't
amend. They can't come back and change their
deeds.
Yeah,
we want to keep 10 off of.
The homeowners association can change their own documents on their own. So if it's prohibiting daycares and stuff at one time, they can all get together. If it's built out in 10 years and they want to change it, they just change it at their own level.
Because I'm actually going to go over this with Charlie Nicholson, the lawyer in Sanford. We deal with him a lot. I actually really want to go over the whole thing with him before it gets recorded with the subdivision itself, I guess.
Yep.
I tell you, I would recommend that.
Oh, I'm absolutely doing that, for sure.
Yeah, keepers. I mean, you don't want people with big semi-trucks out there, but...
And I don't want junk cars in the yard either.
Right.
You know what? We weren't just...
The local, you know,
chickens,
someone to take care of the neighborhood kids is
would
be a huge benefit.
It's kind of set up as a 55 and older because that's what we've seen mostly, but this is not. So maybe a daycare in this, if everyone had 2 kids, there's 20 kids there, one person had a daycare, should make a killing.
Right.
It could be a needed service in there.
Yeah.
you wouldn't even have to leave the neighborhood to bring them to somebody's house.
Yeah, small-scale landscaper. Gardener.
Yeah, now that's...
But you gotta be able to keep it in the garage or something.
Yeah, that's something, fall super, if someone had a lawn care business, I mean, I don't, that goes, falls on you, doesn't it?
Home occupation, probably, yeah. We try to call it. As long as it was neat, clean, and the stuff was in a building or something, easy. Otherwise, it would be commercial use.
Have a guy pulling in there with three pickup trucks and trailers and lawnmowers everywhere.
Or having a crew, having a crew of 10 people come in.
Okay, this is how you say, you got the crew come in, you got deliveries throughout the day from different...
Right, you don't want that.
Yeah, you don't want that, but someone who's just gonna have a pickup truck and a mulch pile in the back or something, small.
I'll let Nicholson guide me through that. Yeah, we don't want to, it only takes one bad egg to ruin it for the whole neighborhood.
Exactly.
Yeah.
You know?
All right, anything else that grabbed your attention?
The verbiage for the fire protection was all houses. If 10 just happens to be a garage with no house, then the fire protection won't be pertaining to him.
Can we leave him alone on that? If he's building a garage now, then ends up building a house with a...
Then the house will be protected.
But we don't want to... I don't want to have to...
Garage wouldn't have to be.
Right, but if he's building just a garage right now, I mean, if it's not living space, he shouldn't have to.
Correct, and that's why I was just clarifying the verbiage, just as all houses. So if he just built the garage...
Don't need fire protection.
Don't need the fire protection.
And that's now, fine with those guys for the fire department?
Yeah, well, it's verbiaged as all houses, and most times we've always seen all houses go in. Mm-hmm. I know one individual looking at one of the lots would not be building a house right away, just be building a garage to store stuff in.
So every... all... 10 lots are required to have, if there's a house on it.
The house will be protected.
Right.
You guys are going to work on your home on a dock, cleaning that up. And I think really the last thing is just that Goose Pond, Nason Road coming together. I'll run that past the road commissioner to see if they had concerns.
I'd like to see something added along the road. If you think of the lots behind the homes and putting into the conditions a row of, let's say, arborvitaes that would in growth in 2 or 3 or 4 years, give each one of those lots privacy, seeing that a lot of these trees, and even though we're leaving the thing undone, but a lot of those trees are not there in a lot of places. And I just have seen that kind of thing, and I thought, oh, that's great for people who have families or whatever, and they use the backyard, they can, you know, have a natural kind of a separation. I mean, I don't know.
I'm going to leave it. I'm going to try to leave it.
Shade, but you don't want it.
Yeah, I'm going to leave as many trees as I can on the property lines, but other than that, I mean, some people care, some people don't care.
Mm-hmm.
They're going to have their choice when they drive up, you know, when they go to deal with a builder or a realtor or whatever to buy the house, they're going to see this is what they're buying, whether it's got a tree line in between the house. Some are going to have them and some aren't, I would say.
Yeah, percentage-wise, what are we saying? I mean,
I honestly couldn't tell you because it's the way the property lines. You'd have to know exactly where the property lines are. And I mean, I think Joe's got a couple flags out there because some are straight, some as you get down are at an angle.
Mm-hmm.
So it's hard to see exactly where the line is. But before I do anything on a lot, we're going to know where those lines are, and I'm going to try to leave all the trees I can on the property lines. Mm-hmm. We're not going to touch. I would say a good 20-foot buffer on each side.
It's 10 foot setback from each.
Yeah.
But then again, if you had a tree in that buffer leaning this way towards the house,
you're gonna
want to get rid of it now.
Absolutely.
Before you put the house in. And leave the lower growth stuff.
Just a little stuff we've done. I've had a few like little hemlocks and pine trees that were where I figured was the property line, and we're trying to leave those, the ones that are green all year long.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to
We've had some subdivisions with no-cut buffers in there, and then the people have come back, and the neighbors are really good friends, and they wanted to make a path and cut a way through, and can't cut it.
Or the kids want to play.
The kids want to play.
So you think that's an issue with shade, too, as far as what you might have in it, as far as...
Yeah, and plus, if you do something like a stand of arborvitaes, the first tree that starts to die on one side becomes an eyesore, and... Mm-hmm. I don't know.
All right,
but it's true that sometimes people families, they prefer the open space in the back, because the kids can play, they can look out the window, they can keep an eye on it,
Or let them do it if they want to do it.
Right. Yeah,
I'm going to leave as much as I can, and then if a homeowner wants to, if two homeowners want to cut everything in between their houses, if they're good neighbors and they want to clean it up and have a joining lawn, that's going to be their business, not mine.
Well, per the plan, they're not supposed to do that.
Well, that's who's going to go around and start piecing property lines between neighbors?
We get the call.
Something more uniform and solid. You know, they've got the option, but where, some person's barrier, then they, you end up shading your neighbor's house and you won't be friends after that, so, if your neighbor can't have the garden because of your privacy.
So that brings up note 11 where it talks about the clearing limits, lots are suggested as buffers. Either they're a buffer and we're going to enforce it, or I'd say get rid of all of note 11. Do you want a bigger plan?
I can see it.
No problem with putting mine like
that. Now, the word suggested is in there, which would be impossible to enforce because it's suggested. It wouldn't be worth our time.
Yeah, but we want the idea. Don't we want the idea of trying to keep the buffer there? Whether or not it's enforced is probably not our issue.
Well, if it's on the plan, then the town has to enforce it. If somebody calls and says, my neighbor's cutting the buffer, then we would go out and...
But it says suggested.
And then it says suggested, so...
So you're saying if you're going to suggest it, why say it at all?
Exactly.
And I'm saying if you suggest it, then nobody's going to call you back, and you know, you're still trying to get the idea out there, then we're going to keep them.
Well, they'll still call, and then I go out and have an issue because all the others weren't suggested, and then I get called on it that it's only a suggestion.
It does have to back you up a little bit anyways, in the homeowner's docs, not section 9K. This says, by acceptance of a deed, and the subdivision shall agree not to move any vegetation lying outside of the clearing area shown on here. So, I mean, maybe if the word suggested is the only issue to that, we do have that in the homeowner's documents that we recorded that says they're not supposed to touch that particular area as well.
Does that give you any?
No, I don't see how to enforce that.
They should
change it to shall or eliminate 11, whatever the board feels.
Well, that's a toughie.
I mean, you could, you'd have your mind and thoughts of who's living there, and it's like a buffer would be good, but as Billy said, if they want lawns right up in between them, the only thing with the lawn would be more volume of water coming down, because just in a sheet off, get into the ditch line and head into the... must be 80 feet by 60 feet detention pond there, good sized pond.
Would you say shall, then?
Shall or shall, and then it's enforceable.
They can have one big open yard if they want it, which is pretty rare, but I've lived in situations like that, and
I keep referring to
where several houses, they have one big open backyard.
I keep referring to the subdivision we're doing right now in Wells. We've only got a couple lots left, and almost every lot has no trees in between at all. The same idea with the cluster, and everybody's, we're doing all the lawns and everything too, and there's a hardwood tree here and there that's being left, and everything else is being cut. And all the lawns are joined, you know, just the neighbors are mowing up to the property lines.
Are you putting?
But they have the right to put it if they want to, right?
We do the whole thing, yeah, we built the road and then we bought all the lots.
I meant here.
Am I doing lot?
Are you doing lots here?
Yeah, because I want the earthwork for every house lot, so I'm gonna sell a lot knowing that I'm doing the earthwork on it, so, yeah.
We would require that the disturbed area is vegetated.
So we're back, we haven't really settled what we wanna do here.
I think the buffers are a good idea, given that the lots are kinda small and that the rest of the lot may be void of trees. And it doesn't prohibit someone from cutting down a dead tree or hazardous tree or thinning out the trees or.
Or trampling the path through.
Yeah, or making a path or just, I mean, we could put something that says like, you know, there has to be.
Mutual agreements.
There can only be, you know, no more than 10 feet between trees and the buffer or something like that, but I think if we just said it's.
We go to the point system that using the shoreline zone, 12 points.
And I will do my best to leave as many trees as I can on the
property. Seems like a good idea.
I'd like to leave as many as I can, to be honest.
There's gonna be lots of little birch trees growing and they can kind of select the ones they want.
Yep.
Selective cutting within the buffer, maintaining.
Well, they're gonna have a lot at first, so I would think they would do that anyway, so I'm sure that. I think it would be nice to have a buffer there, but one that they can, you know, manipulate somewhat.
Oh, definitely better to start with a buffer and for them to eventually decide to get rid of it rather than to.
Yeah, so just get rid of it. It says the clearing limit shown between the lots are buffers between the lots. Something like that. A little rhetorical there. But.
What's it say right now, Kenny?
Is the clearing
building
number 11 clearing limit? The clearing limit shown between the lots suggested as buffers between the lots.
Why don't I just leave it alone?
Because we didn't like the word suggested, by the way.
Yeah, and we enforce it.
It's just kind of problems.
Buffer zones must maintain 12 points per 25 by 25 area.
I don't think there'll be any problem.
What is the point system?
It's shoreland zoning, each tree is worth so many points.
Like
so
a bigger
tree is
4 points,
a little tree is 1 point. So in that 25 by 25 area, you'd have to maintain 3 big trees.
Assuming there were 3 big trees there.
Those would be.
Right, 3 big trees.
later on,
right.
You can thin it up to 3 trees eventually.
So what makes it right for you? So that you can do what you need to do.
So according to
them, well, it's what the developer wants to do out there and what you guys want to do.
Yeah.
It works for you guys.
Are we all in agreement that we kind of want a buffer?
Yeah, I would not eliminate the existing buffers, that's for sure.
Right.
So again, we do have it in the homeowner's docs that they can't touch it.
But it's putting it up on the plan so that it's easier.
So number 11.
So just change to shall?
So it could say number 11 could read the clearing limit shown are buffers between lots.
Okay.
Or the clearing limit shown between the lots are buffers between lots.
I think you gotta start over because it's kind of
messy. It's rhetorical there.
You can't, oh yeah, okay.
I'm still with the buffer zones must maintain 12 points for 25 by 25. And there's a zone
and it's measurable.
That works for me. Yeah.
That allows them to cut up to, or if they want to cut an area of plant or something, so it'd be the same.
But it still says it's kind of a
buffer zone. Buffer zones must contain, what was that?
12 points per 25 by 25. And that would start from the day the new people move in. Would be my thought on it. After development, kind of.
Mm-hmm.
Or it starts the day you guys sign the plan.
Yeah.
I'd love to leave it just the way it says on the plan.
Well, I can't enforce suggested.
Yeah, perfect.
Exactly.
You set up jive with your homeowner.
You get the agreement.
Are the two not jiving, boss?
I see what they're saying. I don't see it as big a deal as they do, but I get what they're coming from. It would be unfortunate if that's the only thing we have to change tonight when we've all had this wording for quite a while. I mean, it's just kind of wild. If that's the only thing that holds us up from an approval tonight.
Well, it's something we can't give you final approval until the road is redeveloped, right?
What's wrong with that?
The intersection, but we want to hear from the road commissioner.
Even if the road commissioner doesn't like it, how is that, what makes it his responsibility?
Yeah, they can't do anything about it, he's not a road guy.
Oh, no, I'm just, that's what we just stated about 10 minutes ago.
It's for us to take on, but if they were Walmart, we could tell them to fix the road. It's not their property, I mean, you can't just go.
Oh, I know, that's just what Ken stated 10 minutes ago.
Right, yeah, no, Ken said he wasn't going to talk.
Going for fixing it.
No, I hear you.
I want to leave everything alone so you guys approve it tonight.
Okay, do we need to make a motion on this then, on this number 11?
Do you need to do a standard? I think so, at some point.
Oh, what, A through L, or, yeah.
A through.
Didn't we already, oh yeah, no, wait, that was the other group we did that with?
Yeah.
How about if we get rid of?
Can't we just take Ash's suggestion?
The clearing limit shown are buffers between lots, roads, and properties abutting the subdivision. So we eliminated a couple of. We don't have the word lots in there more than once.
You could do your.
That would be less than that.
How's that sound to you, Ken?
What was the final?
If we say the clearing limit shown. The clearing limit shown buffers between lots, roads, and properties abutting the subdivision. And then the second sentence says, many of these areas were previously cut during the recent timber harvest. They're just making a statement that that's what they are, they're buffers.
So it's essentially taking out suggested as. But making it a sentence. I can't really see it well enough. So.
Well, do you want to just erase that and just put it in your 12-point thing?
Well, it depends if you guys want no cutting there or cutting there.
I mean, to me, my suggestion is just that you have some kind of a buffer. I mean, I was looking for more of a buffer, but I can live with the fact as long as there's a buffer. You know, I guess it comes down to if the homeowner comes along and says, hey, I'd like to be able to pass through or whatever, then I could probably live with that too.
Yeah.
You know, once they get to the point of ownership. I mean, and Bill's saying that he's not going to, you know, he's going to try as hard as he can to keep it, you know.
I want to leave as many as.
Yeah.
Every tree you touch costs money. There's a stump.
Yeah, absolutely. Exactly.
There's a brush. There's a exactly. Hole.
So what was that wording again?
So right now, I mean, you have two lots. There's 10-foot part. You're not supposed to cut a tree within 10 feet of the property line anyway, right? Without, what do you need to do? Just get permission from your abutting neighbor if you want to cut a tree within 10 feet of your property line?
Well, your neighbor's going to be the one to call and ratchet up.
No, I mean, just, you know, say you and I had property somewhere else in Acton, mm-hmm. and I want to cut a tree down and it was 5 feet from the property line. Could I just go do that, or did I have, what did the regs say now?
Oh, you'd be able to cut it. If you're running the shoreline zone, when you're in the subdivision, and you've got a buffer between you that's been agreed, it's the neighbor's going to call when the other neighbor starts cutting. So if we can weed that out, either we want the buffers there and nobody's cutting anything, or we have a point that they're cutting down to, it allows them to maintain, or no buffers in this lawn right up.
Are we here? Are we at a stalemate? What are we doing?
I kind of like the point system, I guess.
It seems logical.
It's kind of like a compromise.
Can we still approve them and with the idea that they'll get the final drawing back to you so that
you can
print it one more time, but you still get your.
Yeah,
you
just leave it there for signatures. You didn't bring a Mylar, right?
I did just in case. I would never leave home without one.
Just in case.
I would never want anything to go, yes, yes, but we don't have any good sign. Of course I have one.
I'll make, I, I, I mean, mean, the buffer with the 12 points kind of makes sense, because that leaves it up to the neighbors what they want to cut, and it gives Ken parameters that he can work within.
Yeah.
And he's used to them.
It's in the ordinance.
Yeah, it's something that we already practice.
All right, then let's just write that in.
So I'll make that motion.
Comments?
It's not worth referencing a zoning section as per 520 because something gets shifted around and then it's in a different section, so just buffer zones must maintain 12 by 12, 12 points per 25-25.
Okay.
Are you going to run up to your shop and print another one real quick while we go to the next agenda?
Hey, I would if everybody was willing to wait.
Talking 15 minutes? Do you have to redo a bylaw?
I just have to change the wording on the thing and hit print. If you guys have anything else to deal with, I can fix that and hear
well,
that.
Bill is parked in front of us, so he can't get out. So,
let's finish the motion. Let's just vote on this thing.
Yeah.
All right, all those in favor? All right, 4-0. Any other issues before we go to the conditions?
Page 85.
Yeah, we've got our cheat sheets. I think it's 85.
Yeah.
All right, I'll read through. A is use will have no adverse impact on spawning grounds, fish, aquatic life, bird, or other wildlife habitat.
Do we have one in the subdivision?
Doesn't matter. They're both the same list.
Somewhere.
Two, or B, use will conserve shore cover and visual as well as actual access of water bodies.
Mm-hmm.
I think that one's in there as well. C, use is consistent with comprehensive plan. That would be yes.
Absolutely.
D, traffic access meets standards contained in ordinance / traffic congestion addressed in accordance with ordinance performance standards. I mean, we've said that we're not going to increase a tremendous amount of traffic.
Yes, it meets the standards contained within the ordinance, yes.
E, site design conforms with all municipal flood hazard regulations.
Yes.
Yes.
Adequate provision for disposal of wastewater, solid waste.
Yes.
Septic's exactly right. G, adequate provision for transportation, storage, disposal of hazardous materials are made. What do you do for fuel and all that kind of stuff with the equipment?
It's a portable tank in the back of a pickup truck.
Mm, so it's, it leaves sight and
yeah, there's nothing there like we talked about with that gravel pit guy there.
Yeah, okay. All right. So that's yes. H, stormwater drainage for 25-year storm without adverse impact on adjacent properties are designed.
Yes.
Yes. I, adequate provisions to control soil erosion and sedimentation.
Yes.
J, there is adequate water supply for demands of proposed use and fire protection. Yes, we have the sprinkler systems. K, provisions for buffer strips, on-site landscaping, adequately protect abutting properties from detrimental features development of development, and such as noise, glare, fumes, dust, and so forth.
Yeah, luckily we changed that.
Yes.
L, all ordinance performance standards applicable to proposed use will be met.
Yes, we've been through that again.
We certainly hope so.
M, archaeological historic resource designated in the comprehensive plan will be protected.
N-A.
We don't know of any.
Indian burial ground?
Yeah, we found any.
Let us know if you find anything.
You get stopped, don't find it.
Pieces of pottery.
All right, so we're good with that.
So you did A is an NA.
A is
A and B are NA.
No, I'm simply no.
I guess A is no.
Right.
Well, it's gotta be yes.
Or yes, yeah. It's not, I said any.
You've got two negatives there.
Yeah, it's gotta be, it's a yes.
It's no. Yes.
Okay, use will consider shortfall, you didn't, what did you say? B was.
B, you said NA.
Okay. All right, so you're covered.
I'm covered.
We got the conditions already here. And the only one we really change is number 11. I guess I'm looking for a motion, unless there's any other comments.
Why did we ask for the well test, the water test?
Oh, we were just kind of talking about the, you know, the water, and they said that they had made a deal with somebody across the street to get the guy's report.
And that's what that says.
And that's what that
yeah, that's for Macklin as yeah. Well.
Now, if we feel like that's going to be consistent with across the street, or we don't really.
Yeah, it's right across the street.
It should be.
It should, yeah.
Yeah, we have no way of knowing for sure. Until
it changes
done.
In our neighborhood all over the place. So.
Does it say somewhere in there that. Well, I guess it would be up to the homeowner to test their own well at this point, right? So.
Yeah. Make a motion that we
accept
the
conditions.
Second.
I'll second it.
All right, comments again.
Yes.
Comments on the motion.
It's the exciting part, man.
Yeah. All those in favor? I'm trying my little.
He's moving on to
Oh, man. Alright, nothing really that we can talk about as far as Monarch. They're not here. I thought at one point that they might be here tonight. But not to be. Ken, you don't have anything more really to add about
Monarch?
What's going on?
No. I missed a couple of meetings. Can I just ask a couple of questions about that
sure.
Particular project? I was just wondering if we heard back from the DEP about their ideas on bonding. Ken?
DEP wants to hold the bond.
Do they want to hold it on the full 30 acres, or do they just want to hold it on 20 acres? Or
they would be bonding everything they have open.
The full 30?
Correct.
And did we talk about whether or not the town would be bonding as well?
We talked about it lightly, and I'm okay if the DEP holds it to try to get another bond out of them. And the bonding's more complicated to track when it comes up and to make sure it's still there versus like the other one, we required a...
escrow account.
Escrow
account. Well, we could still ask this. He's going to do the same thing.
Would you be doing the escrow in the 30 acres or just 10? Because we only did 10 with that, which was 10,000. So if we were looking.
Well, we did 15 with him because of the road, so it was 15,000.
Was it 15?
Yeah.
So we did
yeah.
That on
I was just wondering where we got with that. So the DEP bonds. And how much does the DEP ask per acre? Is that how they do it, or do they.
Yeah, I don't know what the total.
You don't know what the bond was. What the financial.
You could ask if they come in 2 weeks. You can ask Tom.
Oh, they are going to.
Some point they're going to come back. Yes.
Yeah, they didn't have a fuel management plan.
Right.
Yeah.
So they've at least got that and a few other things.
They've eliminated the fuel. Storage.
They got rid of storage?
Yeah, completely. Mm-hmm.
And they're going to have no retail at all now.
Right.
They're not. They never were. So.
Okay. Well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you had another question or two about that too. You had. I thought.
Well, no. It was mostly the bonding. I'm still noodling with that because I don't think it would be a bad idea for the town to hold some money in an escrow account similar to the other guy, if not for the full 30 acres, for some of it. Just these things are expensive to reclaim, you know.
But then it's all on the state. Do that.
Right, if the town didn't hold any money ourselves, and the DEP held the bond, and the DEP decided they didn't have the money in 10 years when we wanted them to reap it, it'd be nice if the town had a little bit of backup to say, oh, well, we have $500 an acre we can throw toward it to get seed and take some of the machine, just spread the lawn back out and blah, blah, blah. But no, I'm just, you know, that's all I'm saying. I think it wouldn't be a bad idea for the town to get a little insurance there too.
I mean, I guess our discussion along the way had been that the state would be the ones that were going to come in and take care of the reclamation part of it if in fact these guys took off.
Right.
I don't know.
We've seen the DEP shrink in the past, you know.
Shrinking
current years, you know, the DEP keeps getting smaller, so it's, you know, it is something. But we still have more time to think about it.
Yeah, we do, because it certainly can come up again when we get back together again. I don't think we ever made a decision with them anyway, did we? With Monarch when we started last... can't remember if in fact...
I think they were in the minutes we just approved. Yeah,
there was no...
No finals.
Nothing, okay. No, I mean specific to...
The bonding.
The bonding.
Okay. It was never discussed.
All right, okay.
Well, we never made any motions or anything.
Yeah, right. Motions.
It was discussed. Now, weren't you interested in... I thought you were interested in being bonded for the first 10 acres or something. If the state would...
I was leery too with it at first, but talking with the Mining Bureau with the DEP, they reassured me that this is common, this is something they do all the time, and they've never seen a town do it and the state do it.
Okay.
They're not giving up any of their bond.
No, that's...
So yeah. It's all of them. And I just assume not be tracking bonds and lines of credit. That's really hard to see. And I think the verbiage with the DEP is 30 days before it expires, they need to renew it or they're going to cash it in. If you don't renew it, they're going to cash it. So somebody's on top of it with a tracking system. And
they put the onus onto the owners.
Yeah, yeah, if you don't renew it in time, then they call the bond.
Then it's default.
Okay.
Any other comments? Like I said, that'll come back. We'll be talking about this again. The Southern Maine invoice for the, I guess, little workshop that we had back in the late summer, I think, that, as I remember Tom mentioning as he kind of put it together, that it was going to be covered by a grant. I mentioned that to him on the phone, and he reiterated that. However, he did say that... he didn't have it in writing.
Oh, that got me recently too. So I should have sent an email and got that. Well, that was Mike Morris's verbiage with some resource protection. He was good on it. Follow up with an email.
But on top of that, apparently this invoice has things that are charged to it that are specific to the Nason Farm subdivision. So I guess the suggestion that we've kind of come to is send it back to Southern Maine and tell them to get it at least right. I don't know where else to go with it as far as them sending us a bill for the workshop itself.
Right. So you're going to ask them to separate so that we do pay for the finding of facts.
Mm-hmm. I had a note here that Nason Farms paid in full too. Also, we'll mention that when he comes back, that you go to Southern Maine, you're paid in full, and because I'll be dealing with them for years and years, so we can get that at least off of the bill. And I'm sure there must be other invoices. I don't know if he's paid anything or not, but there's got to be some more invoices than what they've just charged here for reviewing that whole subdivision plan.
They estimated $1,300 in the beginning.
How much is the actual invoice for the workshop?
The boardmanship workshop was $150, $7.18 for mileage, $35.60 for dinner for two. $42.78
on that. Were they coming from Sanford?
It's only 16 miles.
7 o'clock in the
evening.
But dinner for two?
Sure. I know.
It's not exactly a day trip.
If we had to eat dinner and after, that's besides the point. So.
Coming from work.
And they charge $60 to review the
subdivision. My honey bills for
$6?
$60 to review the subdivision.
Oh, so we're at $250-ish.
$250, $278.
So, if in the end we end up having to eat this, how do we have...
I think we'll have to subdivide to pay the $252.78.
I bet he would.
We'll get a check out of him tonight.
Hold the motto.
I mean, I'll just check with him too and see what he's paid.
Okay, yeah. All right. So you're comfortable with that at this point on as far as the agenda?
Yeah, just so you guys know.
Yeah, all right.
$35.60 for dinner for two, that's not that bad.
It isn't.
It must have been somewhere. Something between Subway.
No, probably Willie's.
Yeah. I don't think so.
Willie's.
Do you have anything from code enforcement?
One of the areas in the zoning ordinance what we put in about 12 years ago was allowing people to build two houses on one lot for the kids coming back to watch the parents or the parents coming back to watch the kids. The ordinance is so cumbersome or so large that it's really two lots. So we really haven't used it. Everyone that looks at it, it doesn't help anybody. And I was just wondering if the board wants me to relook at that to try to see if there's a use that we could do. Because now, unless you're in clerical rural, it's really, you're looking at two full-size lots, a little reduction in road frontage or something like that. So it's not helping the two separate lots. Maybe we could look at a duplex or something like that. And everyone always starts out with the in-law apartment above the garage. And I haven't figured out why the in-laws go above the garage, because they're older, and my parents are getting older, and they're coming back, and you're putting them above the garage. So I don't know if it's something you guys want us to look at over the winter, or...
Where is it in here? I remember that, because one of my neighbors was thinking it's wanted to build another house.
Well, it's
using the same driveway.
Yeah, yeah. It started on Blueberry Hill Road years ago.
They should have been able to do it. You know what I mean? It's just one of those.
I think it's a footnote in the chat. Page 15, footnote 9. Square feet and 350 feet of road frontage.
And so your suggestion is you want to omit it?
It's not working. We've never used it since it's been in there. If you guys want this to work, we have to reduce the lot size or the road frontage. Because right now, people would have to build a road usually to gain the road frontage to make sure they've got enough.
So this 200,000 square foot lot couldn't divide and give a piece of that property to a relative to build?
You're almost at that. When I review it with most people, because the verbiage goes on that you can never divide the lot, and I'm like, you might as well, if you can divide it now, you might as well divide it now. So it's really not being used for the intent that we thought it would. It's too big of a lot and too much road frontage.
Mm-hmm.
Is it like 5 acres, 4 or 5 acres? What is that?
I get 4 or 5 a year. I had a lady hang up on me the other day and said she's leaving town.
I didn't vote for her.
She's going to live with the kids instead of the kids coming back.
4.57 acres.
Yeah,
so it's about a 5 acre lot, which used to be thinking of minimum lot sizes, but now everything's kind of shrinking back. and maybe it's a common well they use or a common septic or something like that. But if you guys want, you know, I can take a look at it throughout the winter and see what other towns are doing and see if there's something we can do with that.
If you have the time, that would be wonderful.
Always
want to
make
this is more useful.
That's another topic. Right after town meeting, I had a couple come in, and they've been trying to subdivide, and they're in resource protection. And they said, well, resource protection's gone. They got voted out. I said, I don't think so. As it is, apparently nothing changed. Both articles are still in there.
Yeah.
So they...
Well, it depends on your opinion on what happened.
Well, their opinion was wrong, that resource protection is removed throughout the whole
town. Oh, absolutely, yeah, that's correct. Yeah.
Evidently, they said it goes back to the way it was. They think it meant 10 years ago.
Oh.
So they said resource protection's
gone. So that's another issue we'll probably have to look at over the winter, what the board wants to do with those two articles. We want to just pick one, strike one out, and leave one in, or try to strike them both out, or...
I think the intent of that meeting was to strike them both out.
What the voters pushed through?
Yeah.
Yeah, what they requested, yeah.
That's why I didn't go. I was going to vote no for both of them. I mean, if you can't vote no, what's the point of voting?
We did, though. There was.
I know, I heard that. Yeah. I saw half
Richard
the meeting today, but I only got halfway through it.
The selectmen didn't meet after that.
I didn't start it until after 6.
The following Thursday, and then tonight, if they met, they were only there for a half an hour because I passed Ted when I was coming over babysitting at 5:30. Mm-hmm. So I
babysit one of your grandkids, right?
One of mine?
Yeah.
Of course.
The other thing I know we're looking at, probably going to look at over the winter, is the sign ordinance again, bringing that back up.
Okay.
You're talking about commercial signs?
Yeah.
Front properties?
Yeah, that got done in a hurry and it has a clause in it that's never really worked.
It, exactly. So I'm thinking of sending a letter out to the commercial businesses where there's not that many, bringing in like Dasco signs to help us look at it, see what they're using in other towns. Obviously, we don't want it to look like Route 1 in Saugus, but yet the businesses need to have enough signage to work, so
sure.
Something, and so it's...
Yeah, and if you shrink signs down too much, they're useless.
Yeah.
You can't go buy them at a certain speed.
Yeah.
Right,
you know? I've been trying to read Mishad Marina out there, at 50, it's pretty tough.
Yeah, well, even just in. Going through towns where they stack the signs,
yeah.
You know, and
yeah.
Mm-hmm. You have no idea what's there, I mean, unless you stop and get out a notebook. So, yeah. What happened to the Little Red Schoolhouse?
It passed.
That's what I didn't get to the end of the meeting. When I shut it off, they still hadn't voted yet for.
That's because the first one took quite a bit of time.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I'm mid meeting.
Then everything went kind of boom, boom, boom.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So Little Red Schoolhouse, she came in the next day for a permit, and we have to file an application, and you have to go to the planning board. Not again. So I'll review the application. Still, all the questions we had prior to the document still exists. Does it apply to her? Because she was before it. It's a best possible location. We've already done a best possible location.
No, it's before the board.
There's three means: town meeting vote, Maine Historical Society, you guys. Does she pick it? Do we pick it? If one's told no, does she go to the next one till she gets the answer? And we'll just clean it up. Well, I'll take a look at it and touch base with the town attorney on it, get his opinion, and...
Which attorney do you speak with? One of them is kind of involved in this.
Correct, right? So I'd be using the other one, the one who's at the town meeting. So once I have a time to go through, look at it, come up with a list. So she's going to want to be on the next agenda.
She's already
so. And I would imagine it's going in the agenda. I was thinking conditional use because I was stuck in the resource protection, but I believe it's just the best practical location with different parameters to look at it with.
And
which
those
is
different
what it
parameters
would have been
would be
exempt from setbacks
because of the historic.
It's too bad we couldn't resolve it just with the valuation.
That's right.
It's done, yeah.
You're gonna put it in a dumpster. So that's the 3rd of December.
So it's gonna be a busy winter.
And we have, we're assuming we're gonna have Monarch here on that night too, right?
No. No, and...
What date is that?
The 3rd.
Tuesday.
I might be out of town. But anyway.
I am for most of it, but...
How did the thing at UNH go?
Really good.
It was good.
I wanted to go, but the weather was too good. And now I'm, you know, just wrapping up and if it was mid-December, I would have gone.
Yeah, you would have been colder. We were cold.
It was cold.
Oh, you went? Yeah, I'm glad someone was cold.
How many acres was that parking lot? Do you remember? Was it 7?
7.5.
One of the parking lots, 7.5 acres that they drained through multiple different LIDs to try to see which works, what doesn't. And I think they're on their 3rd or 4th version of ripping things out, changing it all.
Part of that, though, was because of the research, too.
Oh, exactly, yeah. Yeah, it's all research, what's working, what isn't, rip it all out, let's try this, how about that. So, I mean, when you start talking 7 acres of pavement all coming into this one area to be treated, and then reducing the volume is one theory, and then eliminating the pollutants is really the tougher stuff. And they're finding a lot is the copper, which they're getting off the brake shoes from the streets that are coming on, and the zinc coming off the guardrails. The galvanization of that. So when they're pulling all these chemicals,
don't even think about it.
No, and that's what they're trying to do. Now, what system gets the chemicals out? And it seems like 80% was a real good achievement level. Trying to get that extra 20 was really difficult. But the percentage really started going downhill at 5 or 10% of lot coverage. But or I use lower or lot coverage. It's more the drainage area. And we're 20% lot coverage maximum in town, but you'd have to look at all the areas in the drainage area, so.
And they were saying that
so
one of the lots...
So what are they using for metals then? Like, just something to precipitate it out that you can scoop up, or... I mean, or is it going to a treatment? To like a water treatment?
It was going into that lumpy stuff that he kept talking about that he had to keep it from being a pudding.
Yeah.
So what's copper? It's a negative, right?
I think so.
So you need something
to grab it.
Positive.
To grab it.
And the big thing I always thought was getting your sedimentation, your silt out of the water. Because once you've got that out, that's a lot of it
right
there.
Right.
A
lot of the metals are in there.
Yeah, yeah. So once you can get that out, then you're doing pretty good. So some of the areas that they were looking at, they're treating the water, and when that storm water leaves their area, it's cleaner than the river that it's being dumped into.
That was the example they used, was the Target down on Route 33
in Greenland.
Greenland, yeah.
Yeah, and I remember the whole, nobody wanted that there because it was the wetlands. And once they treated it with the porous pavement, which we now know gum kills porous pavement, as they're using that as you go into the entrance of the convenience stores, people spit their gum out before they go in, it just gums up the porous pavement.
Well, that makes sense, but I hadn't thought of it as an overall thing.
Kind of thing.
You hear about all the successes of it, of course.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't think about people with
their in the porous concrete, they're having a lot of problems with people putting salt on it.
Don't they know gum kills birds?
No, gum kills everything, yeah.
They showed us, they took us on a tour, and they showed us a sidewalk, large sidewalk at the university that's on a hill. That used to be where water used to come in, go right across Main Street at the university. Now, hardly anything even reaches the road, kind of a deal, all because of the difference in the
But they can't get maintenance to talk to facilities managers, so maintenance is the biggest problem. And as we got there, that whole area, was they had just raked all the leaves off the area and threw it into the walkways where the porous
papers
were, and it's filling up all the areas in between. So it's education, and that was $200,000-$300,000 worth of papers.
That was $300,000 job.
And they just raked it all out, and now it's going to gum up in between all the stuff. So
why is the gap between the papers? Is it pretty wide?
Well, it's not. It's deceptive, but because I think that there's these two channels on the side, it must give you some more space that you don't necessarily see on the surface.
I
because
see.
The surface air space was really
quarter
inch. You can have a small one, so a high yield doesn't get
you don't want to trip on it. Yeah.
And those kind of pavers, no issue with weather. You know, these guys said it was down for 5 years, and they looked like they were great. They looked terrific.
And when we watched the video of the installation, there was a machine went and grabbed the top layer of the pallet of the pavers and went over and put the whole pallet pavers, 40, 50 of them in
right
one
place.
Shot.
Yeah.
And then they just kicked them all in together versus one at a time type thing. But a lot of the technology is moving to all underneath the parking lot is detention areas of some kind. And I've always been thinking you take a little bit of water and get it in the ground, but if it's contaminated, then you want to treat it somehow to a maintenance area. It all comes down to maintenance. Nobody had a good answer for maintenance.
Still, it's always been the issue.
Yeah, I know when we were listening to a talk from the Michigan area, the Chesapeake Bay area, they were using prisoners. And then we were talking that, well, when your house gets broken in from the prisoners, because they come back.
They made a special design kind of plow that was in Portland. It was a paver that was coming up with machinery to maintain their own impervious pavement.
You made the comment that
they were having to design equipment to maintain it.
Any of the things that they could design, if they could design it so that they could be maintained with the vacuum, the vac machine, that would be the ideal. Because towns are willing to do that. You know, they go around with a big vacuum and they would suck everything out kind of a deal. Except that most of the different things that we saw, that wasn't the way to do it. Mm-hmm. Or at least a lot of them weren't the way to do it. You had to do more than that. I was pretty impressed with the one where he made the comment, was down by the horse barns in that parking lot, and he made the comment that there used to be, I think he said, 6 inches of water that crossed the whole stop sign near the whole intersection. The kids couldn't even walk across it. The cars go across it. And now they're down to nothing.
Yeah, they've reduced the water reading in the parking lot to zero.
Has there been any interest in spot?
We had the help wanted sign up, but it wasn't posted properly, so we'll have we'll repost it for December 2nd. I think I'll choose.
Did she get any responses?
No.
I thought she was going to get one.
Me too, but I think he skipped down there and went to the top. So, cannot follow directions.
Great.
Yes. So she'd take it at the second, that's the day before our meeting. So that'd be good.
And just to get back to resource protection for a second, your enforcement of the resource protection in accordance with the what we've been doing at town meeting, you're doing the same thing you did before town meeting in terms of enforcement.
You would have to be out of the shoreline zone.
Right, you're accepting applicants for that outside the shoreline zone.
Because that's
region.
The most stringent one, right?
Yeah. Right, because for somebody thought that both are still in place now. Okay.
Both are still in place.
Or, well, yeah.
But there's a more stringent.
Just ask the town meeting, see what they think.
Yeah, I know.
You go from nothing.
Yeah.
Everything oh,
I hear
gone.
That.
Is that it?
Just waiting on the.
Oh, yeah, sign.
How many of us have to sign that thing?
Well, technically
three.
Quorum's
three. Quorum's
three.
Just a quorum.
You're
going to
be a
volunteer. Just sorry about that.
Yeah.
We're
going
to roll. 15 minutes, huh?
That foggy night.
Is it foggy?
Why does it take
15 minutes
for the machine to turn on?
Yeah.
Oh, here we go. Here we come.
Oh, good.
All righty.
All in favor to adjourn? Did Southern Maine Regional give you a bill at all for reviewing
that? No.
All right, so you probably have an outstanding bill with them.
Yeah, they haven't, I have to pay them to review it.
Yeah, you have to get good information.
Well, they have my information, so they would send me a bill, right?
You would think. We have one here, but...
How much is that?
$252.78.
That's livable.
I don't think it's all inclusive, but it does include two dinners.
I couldn't believe that.
You say itemized on board.
Yeah, it was. It's been... I could see buying the dinners if they weren't charged. It'd be the nice thing to do. Okay, we got to start from the beginning because we don't know what he's changed by anything.
Don't even say that.
So how's 11 read?
The only thing that's changed...
Oh, yeah.
I've changed the wording on note 11 to read, the clearing limit shown on are buffer areas between the lots, roads, and properties abutting the subdivision, as he had suggested. Many of these areas were previously cut during recent timber harvests. The trees within these areas shall be maintained utilizing the 12 points per 25 foot by 25 foot area system as further described in the current town of Acton ordinances.
Okay.
Besides that, I didn't change anything, I swear.
So we good? We approved it. Do we have to do anything else besides sign? That's it. We're good.
What do we do if the road commissioners come back and say?
The roads.
It's over, Virginia.
Going on. Going to the trucks.
That was doing a lot of reading.
You don't have any control.
I'm telling you.
They were going to make a suggestion that they look into it.
Oh, wow.
We were going to say no.
In this case, where it's a flat road that he's paving, I don't really see a big issue with it. But we should look at the ordinance for off-site improvements for
the
future things.
Where do they live around here?
Okay, we'll have to add that to your list.
Do you see much that, Joe?
Off-site improvements? One time, I had a bunch of townspeople in Lebanon convince the planning board that there needed to be a guardrail.
Well, now I've just...
At an intersection, I was a few hundred feet down the road. In that instance, I definitely didn't agree with it.
The guardrail or the off-site improvement?
The guardrail was probably sufficient, but that's a lot of money to ask a developer. In that particular instance, I think a lot of people thought the developer's pockets, just because they're in developing, doesn't mean there's any money in it. A lot of these, especially for the golden roads, they don't do well on.
Credit, right?
And that particular instance, that was a pretty hefty bill. It was a pretty substantial guardrail. I was a little disappointed in that. You know, but again, a situation like this, I think where it becomes tough, looking at the records and looking at the old deeds, this road used to have this V in it. You know, I think they've already come and corrected it and made it a little bit of a T at one point in time. And if you're going to try to do anything further, I think you have to take land from this person.
That's what I was thinking.
I'm sure it can be done in the public's best interest, but I think it's above and beyond the planning board process here right now.
Just when Manfred moved to Walterboro, so he had them practically rebuilt the whole town.
Oh, yeah.
Do you have to sign during the meeting?
Probably.
Well, then we should get up to it.
I'll be reviewing.
I'm just looking to see where I signed it.
Oh.
Anywhere. Just as big as you can.
Take two lines.
Make it look like we're over here.
All right.
I've got a couple.
This one's worse. This one's just a little bit too big. The other one is 5 feet.
Mine's too big.
Okay.
Oh, this city, right?
Mm-hmm. It works.
No.
Jeremy gets a big sharpie.
There you go. Gotcha. That's right.
Does it work? That goes to York County.
Does this one work?
Yeah, I'll record
that goes
it.
To York County.
Bring you guys one with the official recording information on it. Same thing, I need to distribute copies to everybody. We have Central Maine Power needs a couple of their review. Just getting started doling out copies of this thing.
The other one works on this. Oh, you did that one. I think you did it for a...
No.
Those are no good damn.
I prefer not. I'd rather give you one of those than one of them.
Sure.
This is my third time.
She told me that she was interested to the level of if they didn't find anybody, she would, you know, come out as an alternate. And I mentioned to her that she needed to...
Thank you all very much.
Okay, yep. Thanks, guys.
Is this extra?
Oh, yeah.
It was a lot easier than they told me it was going to be.
Do you need anything else from me for your files?
We're
just
good.
The board version of this.
You got all your checks?
I think we're good.
Yeah, you just checked with Southern Maine Regional, see if you owe them any money.
Yep.
Yeah, they moved now.
Yeah, Saco.
They're
Saco, right?
Oh, they did?
Yeah.
Oh. That's why they charged for their...
They changed. Yeah, they charged for moving fees.
Is there a motion to adjourn?
I'll make a motion.
Second, all in favor?